please welcome CEO, Mandiant, Google Cloud, Kevin Mandia.
Thank you. Thank you. It's good to see 2,000 of my closest friends here today. I've got 20 minutes, but I have 40 minutes of material, but I think you're entitled to as much as we can fit in over the next 20 minutes, looking at the year in review of 2020. So I'm going to start off with kind of by the numbers, what we saw doing 1,163 intrusion investigations during the year. Then I'm going to talk about the apex attacker and what they did. Then what top defenses are doing against maybe that top 1-2% of offense that's out there. And then we'll kind of wrap up with the concerns of the CISOs. So with that, let's get moving with the year in review. I already mentioned the number of cases that we responded to. Well, we are, even as I stand here right now, responding to over 100 security breaches. And these are the intrusions that circumvented common safeguards and the intrusions that got to a scale and a scope where people needed Mandiant to come in and figure out what happened and what to do about it. In addition to learning from the front lines in the intrusion investigations, we have a global threat intelligence group of over 350 folks. I think the slide says approximately 342. We snuck a few more in there that speak 34 languages globally deployed. When we look at the frontline intelligence that we're getting, one of the things that we've learned is we're just detecting faster. We've been tracking this stat since actually even before this slide, you know, shows. And if you look back a decade, it took over 200 days for folks to notice that, hey, we've got a problem. So when you're looking at global median dwell time, we kind of use dwell time to define from the moment you're compromised to the moment as a victim organization, you actually know about it and you're aware about it. But we look at this globally, we're down to 16 days. So we've made tremendous progress in getting faster. Now we can slice and dice this data for dwell time based on investigation type, geography, and internal or external detection. So let's do that. The global median dwell time in all regions for ransomware actually went up. And a lot of you'd be like, wait a minute, you just saw a slide from IBM that says you got 4 days from the moment a ransomware actor's in to the moment you got a problem. What we're learning here is this is from the moment somebody breaks in to the moment you know that they broke in and are deploying ransomware. And I think it's the separation of duty that increased the length of time of detection. There was a time in my career where if you got hacked and ransomware is deployed, the stigma was, you're not that good at defense. What did you do wrong? But now we have professional hackers, 1099 employees. No, they're not that, but you get the idea. You have apex attackers breaking in, and then you have another group buying the access to deploy the ransomware. And that could be part of the reasons why we see a delay. Whether right or wrong, this is what we witnessed. Then you see in non-ransomware cases, tremendous improvement from the moment you're breached and someone's trying to do espionage and steal and pilfer information to the moment you're aware about it, went down dramatically by 19 days. Then let's look at it by region. And there you have it. You can all read the slide. We got faster in every region except for one. And when I read the forensic reports from the one, I don't have a good story as to why. Just case type, sophistication, could be the progression of maturity of the detection capabilities in those regions, but it went up in one region. And then in general, and this is kind of interesting, you look at detection internal versus external. For ransomware, external detection is faster because a lot of times you have a ransomware actor external to you saying you've got a problem. And then internal detection is faster. Getting to detection, something we've tracked on, how do organizations know they've been breached? A lot of folks get drilled, and I was talking to a CISO yesterday, where the people want to be the first to know that they've had a breach. That has always been, in my career, rare. I think in the 90s and early 2000s, when we responded to breaches, it was always internally detected. But when we started Mandiant in 2004 and started tracking this, external detection was over 90% of the time for the breaches that we were hired to respond to. It is not abnormal for you to be in an organization, get a knock on the door from a third party, whether a government entity or third party provider of security somewhere, and say you have a problem. So we are the same exact place. 63% of the intrusions we responded to were external detection last year and 10 years ago. And I think it's always going to be that way. What we are noticing, though, with dwell time coming way down, when you get external notification today as compared to 10 years ago, you're getting external notification you believe and is actionable, and you can do something about it. And I think for most of us that have been in security for the last two decades, you've all gotten that external notification that wasn't a problem. We're doing a lot better than that now. Bottom line, if a third-party security provider gives you a call or gives you an email and tries to work with you on something, we're just getting more fidelity into that. The investigations in ransomware went down. And I don't know if every other vendor's seen the same thing, but from our perspective, what we were hired to respond to, less ransomware cases. This may be a misleading stat, but I went through our case reports, and in the 1,100-plus intrusions we responded to, less than 1%, or about 1%, had an insider involvement of some kind. But realize the bias to Mandiant investigations are that people hire us when they believe they have an external intrusion ordinarily. We do get hired sometimes for insider threat. We treat that somewhat differently, but every once in a while we respond to intrusion and we can see that somebody on the inside is in fact working with somebody on the outside. I don't want anyone to walk out of here and think, my gosh, we have an intrusion, who did it, and start looking at your employees. Realize that in my experience, well under 1% of the time did I ever respond to an intrusion, and it was insider involvement. Multiple groups identified is quite frequent, and this matters because when you first have an intrusion and you're responding and you're in that fog of war stage, you're trying to figure out what's the zone of potential outcomes of this intrusion. If it's ransomware, you sort of know, although you still want to know what ransomware group did it, and how do you negotiate with those ransomware groups, how many of them really abide by their word, and how they do business. Same thing in criminal cases you'll get in espionage. You want to know how many groups are in, what do they do, how do you remediate? And it's just amazing to me, and people don't really think about this. If you were compromised from one group, a lot of times there's more than those folks targeting you, and 27% of the time, multiple groups. We've had four or more in different government agencies and organizations when we respond. This perhaps is a big change in my career is, so how are folks breaking in? And I can tell you, between 1993 and 1998, and you're like, my God, he's going back that far. Yes. Every time I responded to a breach, publicly available exploit, vulnerable service, mostly Unix platform, some Windows by the end of that time frame. Right around 1998, 99, we saw more Windows-based attacks as Windows was getting more popular. From 98 to about 2002, we saw the transition of victim zero going from vulnerability to, I would call, phishing attacks. 2002 to 2019, victim zero, spear phishing. Literally every single year, spear phishing was the number one way folks broke in, and that started to change in 2019. And when you look at it today, right now, about 32% of the time, victim zero. When we know victim zero, it's a vulnerability, not a 0 day necessarily, but a 1 day, 2 day. And that means it changes your defenses. That means patch management's back on the top thing. Anti-phishing's doing its job pretty well, and attackers are going for that. When we looked at it by region, Europe was different, though. Spear phishing was still number one for the intrusions that we responded to in Europe. And in Asia-Pac, in the intrusion set that we responded to there, victim zero was, in fact, either prior compromise or stolen credentials. So from my experience, we often see geo differences in this category, but when I looked at the United States, where we responded to most of the breaches, 38% of victim zero was an exploit. So that brings me to what were the top three. Probably no surprises here as to what the top three vulnerabilities that were exploited were in 2022. Hopefully all of you have patched these, identified if you have them, and took care of them. And if you haven't, someone else will find it for you. 0 days is an interesting number for me because we started tracking this literally in the 90s. And when you look at the average 0 days or attacks with no patches between 1998 and about 2019, it was low teens. Some years it was 8, some years it was 13. Exploits in the wild is not really common. And maybe it wasn't common because attackers didn't always need them. They could get in and stay in for a long time using valid credentials and lateral movement. In 2019, we saw 32 0 days in the wild, and we went, whoa, that's a huge spike, double the median, even more than that. What happened in 2019? Probably defenses got a little better, offense, vulnerability research got more mature and better. We had 30 0 days found in the wild in 2020, 81 in 2021. Marquee blowout year for the offense in 2021. And then this year, 2022, 55. We're in a whole nother planet when it comes to zero-day exploitation since 1993. I've never seen anything like this. So what does that mean? Again, now you got to be thinking, I just said, patch the 1 days, got to do that. But what do you do about the 0 days with no patch? So we'll talk about that. And then notice that we cannot attribute the use of 0 days to groups all the time. There's a time in my career where we could. Virtually every 0 day I saw up to about 2015, for the most part, meaning over 90% were in the hands of nations or folks acting on behalf of a modern nation to conduct espionage and predictable activities. That's changed now, where we're seeing financial criminals get it. But the upside of 0 days in 2022, we never saw the spray and pray 0 day like we saw in 2021 in February when Microsoft had a few 0 days in exchange. And by the way, in my whole career, I almost never see spray and pray 0 day attacks. It's rare, hard to have impact on them. So let's break these down a few other ways as to who's doing them. China led the way in innovation and doing vulnerability research and finding the most zero-day attacks as we could attribute. And I show the CVEs being used for cyber espionage. And we can only attribute 13 out of 55, but realize when Mandiant does attribution, we're pretty darn good at getting that right. And we have a high bar for it. I probably could have put more flags from China on this chart. And then we broke it down by vendor, and it doesn't really change. It's going to be Microsoft, Apple, and Google, always the top three because they're the most pervasive. But we have another category that grew a lot, because whenever you have more than the mean average of between 10 to 15 0 days, well, the category that usually grows is the other. So let's take a look into that other on this slide. And that, this breaks it down, by the way, by type of platform, so it won't add the 55 0 days because we have another category there. But what I found unique in 2022 is that the other category had all this network security devices, and it was my opinion when I read through who was finding 0 days on the edge, in your VPNs, in your firewalls, it was China. They led the way in finding 0 days and vulnerabilities that they weaponized in 2022. So let's talk about the Apex attack. You know, I read through our forensic reports. The last one I got to had a great password, so I didn't even try to read it for a long time. When I cracked it open, read it, it was an attack into a defense industrial base organization somewhere. And what was remarkable about this is the apex attacker in 2022 in regards to cost to conduct the offense, hands down, was this account and this attack coming from a group we could attribute to China based on both infrastructure as well as the compression algorithm that they used in their file transfer. So we had a great idea, it was them, we're pretty confident in it. But if you look at this attack, and right now all you're squinting at the 8 font, the way this attack was detected is about 14 FortiGate firewalls just didn't reboot one day. And the question became, why were they booting at all? Somebody placed code out of bounds of where you should be able to access code on these Fortinet boxes and made them actually crash. And when they rebooted, there's a checksum mismatch. That's an interesting detection that you may have a problem. So your security devices are rebooting and getting mismatches in the FortiOS. From there, whoever the attacker then showed zero-day capability with a directory traversal CVE that we published. I'll never get the number right. I think it's CVE 41328. Directory traversal is an old thing, right? But if you can write code into a portion of a protected device that you shouldn't be able to write code to, and maybe append something on a legitimate file and push it in from the FortiManager box, it's going to execute, and you're going to have a backdoor in place. And that's exactly what these folks did to 62 firewall devices. So now you have an attack plane, you have access to a company, and you're on their security plane, and there's no EDR on it. And you've written code to places we couldn't even do forensics on it because it's on the protected portion of a device. Pretty smart place to be. But then it gets even more interesting. Then they go and get access to the VMware hypervisor, and they had a very sophisticated malware framework to go from hypervisor to guest image and put files into the guest images, go from guest image, and guest image to hypervisor. That malware framework, we're still looking at pieces of it. That thing wasn't created in a day. That thing wasn't created in a month. It was created in many months. So we're looking at one case, 0 days were used. Infrastructure without EDR coverage was targeted, in my opinion. Logs were deleted. That is something that was new. When I responded, I've done my 10,000 hours on the front lines doing forensics on Chinese cyber espionage. There were many years, over a decade, where there was not a lot of OPSEC of deleting logs. We were finding, as we scraped memory in the Fortinet machines, looking at the Apache logs that they have, the access logs, that the attackers were using SED and just grepping out, essentially, or tearing out the IP addresses, and they used 12 different source IP addresses. Bottom line, this was the apex attack, in my opinion, on offense. Very hard to respond to, very hard to detect, and there will be more victims than Mandiant will be aware of because of its efficacy and how surreptitious it was. So what do you do about it? Because that's what this conference is about. The threats will change all the time. If you're in an industry like defense industrial base, financial services, you make something that's critical to the health and welfare of 1.7 billion people, you may be targeted by these types of attacks. So what do you do? Well, don't ever forget the advantage you do have. You should know more about your business, your systems, your topology, your infrastructure than any attacker does. And there is the exception is you hired an insider. But the reality is this is an incredible advantage, and it's one that if you can baseline normal and structure things right, you can detect anomalies faster. So I went to my team. I always mention Tim Cruthers, our CISO, whenever I speak, because I'm always like, if you're in the crowd, Tim, please get back to work. But in this, I said, hey, what are we doing to make sure we detect? You know, everybody's got the blocking and tackling for the one day, patch management, and the health and welfare systems very quickly. But what do you do about the O day? And so he said, well, don't forget the one day, focus on the fundamentals. And I want to just, in this slide, I don't have the time to get to all of it, but CISA has a great document on the zero trust model, and everybody defines zero trust in many different ways, but it's great to have a document you can go to that's free at cisa.gov. They have that cool mountain logo that I stole, and it's a journey, and if you just kind of benchmark against that maturity model, you're gonna do a lot of the fundamentals right. I get the question all the time, I'll point this out. Biggest bang for the buck against ransomware, biggest bang for the buck against any impactful attack is multi-factor authentication, period. And figuring out a way to get it everywhere and know that you have it everywhere with some sort of validation is critical. Now for the apex attackers, it's how do you detect them when products don't stop them? That's fine. There's a couple things on the site I'll point out that we do that I think's neat, and I think it's cheap, and it's something everybody should do. Fancy word for it by our security staff was honey tokens. I literally had to make the call, Tim, what is that? To me, that's something we've always done. The fake accounts that are bait, that are cheap as heck to throw in your Active Directory, that nobody uses, nothing should use, but it's sitting there, and an attacker doesn't necessarily know when they first get in, and they will target your identity architecture when they break in. If you have a few dummy accounts and build rules around them that any use of them is bad, that's a great move. That's your free honeypot for your identity architecture being violated or being insecure. So I wanted to point that out. Everything else here you can see, but the manual validation of security processes, to me, I'll talk about on another slide. With 2 minutes left, I wanted to point this out. So what do you see in stage two of almost every single breach? We got to track this amongst the MITRE kill chain. It's PowerShell, bad PowerShell scripts. And there's not a whole lot of software you can buy out there that just immediately instantiates. That's a good script from a good person, and that's a bad script from a bad person. You have to turn on your module logging. You have to study this. You have to get your security operations folks to get visibility into your PowerShell use, your Active Directory, or if you're not using Active Directory, you're in your LDAP or something else, you gotta watch all identity use, period. So that's number one on this slide, and to some extent, that's number five on this slide. Get great at those. Good luck trying to figure out file deletion, because good people and normal people delete it all the time. You can turn object and access tracking on in Microsoft. You'll just get a ton of tough stuff to do. But when you look at this, you wanna build stage two detection. Concerns at a CISO, I don't have the time to go into, but we report on this every year because we get to meet CISOs when they have to transform their security programs, pre-breach to post-breach, where you take security pretty serious. But I want you to look at it if you're a CISO and say, hey, did Mandia miss anything? Or B, did I miss anything that I need to add to my list? So I could have done all 20 minutes on this, and in fact, we could do 45 minutes on this slide alone. Pausing for 3 seconds because I see cameras taking photos, but I'm sure these slides will be online. And then the last slide, kind of, so what are secure, like the mature CISOs of the world, the boards, the executives are doing these four things. at the most mature security programs. First and foremost, they report risk to their boards in a consistent way. It's not like every 90 days the CISO is saying something wildly different than 90 days before. I just made the assumption mature security programs are briefing their boards every 90 days. A lot of companies don't get to do that. You have to know the risks that the assets that matter, the risk to those assets. Then you validate, can those risks become a reality? In my opinion, as much as possible, we do it every 90 days. You have to do a tabletop exercise. Make that tabletop exercise the one that you're most worried about. Ransomware that shuts down something that matters. Client data that's stolen so that you know who's involved in your response if the bad threat becomes a reality. What PR firms you'd work with, who needs to come to the round table to help you decide. And lastly, you need to participate in some community so that your security operations is learning from other people's security operations. So that's as fast as I could do it. Thank you so much for all the cybersecurity professionals, what you do every day. Thank you.